that sort of
this sort of music.
Doing that sort of
another sort of music.
Oh, man. WKCR FM New York, WKCR HD, WKCR.org, or maybe you're listening to the Deep Focus podcast, because this is Deep Focus. I'm your host, Mitch Goldman. This is some music you've probably never heard from Woody Shaw.
Thank you.
Thank you.
No, thank you. You are at the North Sea Jazz Festival, and it's July, of course, July, because that's when that happens. July 14th, 1979, and I discussed that with my guest. So let me take this opportunity to welcome back to the studios of WKCR, Graham Haynes.
Hey, Mitch, thank you. It's always a pleasure to be here.
Especially is,
to listen to the great Woody Shaw. I mean, Jesus, Woody Shaw.
It's funny. Every time we do one of these, and we've done a bunch of them now, and everyone for me has been it's just such a treat. One of the things about it, and we've talked about this, you and I are kind of the same, right? Born right around the same time in New York City area.
I think you're a little younger than me.
Maybe a little bit. I shave off.
Not by much.
I try to knock a year off. One out of every 10 or so, I pull one back. But we came up around the same time, getting into a lot of the same music. I think both of us were big KCR listeners
at that
time, too.
Yeah.
Maybe that's where... Well, we could talk about that, where one would hear...
That's a whole show.
That's a whole show. That's a whole show. But, yeah, when we were coming up, I'm going to let you tell me, who was Woody Shaw?
Oh, wow. Who was Woody Shaw? One of the greatest men to hold a trumpet, to play it, you know. A grand innovator on the highest level, you know. And I say that with no intimidation, no trepidation, no, you know. Woody Shaw, well, those who just heard this track that just played, I mean, there's really nothing else I have to say. You know, a great genius trumpet player, a genius, you know, a hard worker. You know, Woody was a hardworking guy, you know. And you could tell every time I'd see him, I could see that he was in the shed. I mean, you could see him increase, you know, his knowledge and his playing and everything. And I remember seeing Woody Shaw just a few blocks from here at Symphony Space.
Oh, yeah.
And he brought his Tai Chi sensei with him. I can't remember his name. And his sensei did Tai Chi moves on the stage as the band played. And I got into Tai Chi because of seeing Woody. You know, I studied Tai Chi down in Chinatown in the late 1980s because I saw Woody do it, you know.
You'd see him between sets, you know. Everybody else would be hanging out, having a drink, chatting up somebody at the bar. Woody would be
He was very dedicated. He was very dedicated to the art, yeah. Very dedicated to that art. And me being a practitioner of it, I can understand and I can see. I tell a lot of trumpet players this. If you study Tai Chi, and if you really practice it, I mean, if you do the form twice a day, every day, and at that time I was doing it twice a day. I would do it in the morning and I would do it in the evening. After a certain point, the instrument, the trumpet, becomes an extension of the chi. So the chi goes through you and it goes into the instrument. And, you know, it took me a while to notice that, but in listening to Woody, I can hear it. I can actually hear that. I can hear it, and I can, you know, I saw him perform a lot, and I could see how that energy was going through the body into the instrument. And, of course, you know, you still have to practice the instrument. you can't just practice Tai Chi and then expect that all of a sudden magic is going to come out of the instrument, and then you never practice the instrument. But I mean, with Woody, I could see it. And Woody, man, he would drive, and he had these tempos like that piece that just played. The tempo on that, he would drive those tempos, and his drummers, you know, he liked those fast tempos, and he could play all this complex stuff, and it would just like fly through the horn. It would just like fly out of there, and I don't know anyone else who could do that on that instrument.
Yeah,
you know, the way he did it.
Well, that was the stuff I loved.
And then it was what he was playing. He was an innovator. He was a harmonic innovator on what could be played over chord changes and specifically with the trumpet. I was a trumpet player. I'm a cornet player now. Okay, so I was a trumpet player. I started in my teens, and I listened to a lot of the great masters, Dizzy Gillespie, Miles, Freddie Hubbard, and on and on and on and on. What Woody Shaw did was he found a way, and there were others who who began to do it. Freddie Hubbard and Charles Tolliver come to mind. Mm. They opened the door to modal playing on the trumpet over chord changes. But to me, what Woody Shaw did was he completed it. He completed that quest that had already started with others. He found a way to completely create a concept of playing over chord changes and playing modally and moving with the changes at the same time. And that's the great thing about, you know, and it's the way he did it. And then we all tried to copy him. I mean, many of us tried. I remember going to see Woody, and there were trumpet. Woody would always let people sit in.
Yeah.
And I got to play with Woody a few times, and I got to see other trumpet players play with him. And I got to see trumpet players try to outblow him on his language.
Oh, not good.
And, you know, Woody would just let him play.
He yeah.
would let them play. He'd let them all play. And then he would come on at the end. And he would just.
And I got to give a special mention because I know I have a feeling you and I were at some of those same sets. That would be happening between the trumpets. And Steve Touré is keeping up with them on trombone. Which
Yeah, Steve.
Let's give a hand.
Yeah, there's a reason. There's a reason that Woody hired Steve Touré. Steve Touré could keep up with him, you know.
Yeah. Not easy to do.
Not easy on the Oh, man. I can't even imagine. I can't even imagine. I don't know that instrument that well, you know, but.
And that's take nothing away from the rhythm section either, of course.
Yeah. But Woody was. He was something. He was the last. He was.
I know. I have a feeling. I know. Pulling this out of your head, he was the next, and in a sense, he was the last. In a way, I mean, just of that kind of warrior trumpeter coming out of bebop and before and through. He was, you know.
To me, he was the last. That had an innovation like that. He was the last one for me. That's my personal feeling, you know, about him and about the whole lineage, you know, of the trumpet. You know, after that, then you know, you really have to kind of go somewhere else. You have to go because you're not going to outdo him in that.
Yeah.
You know, I haven't heard anybody do it.
Yeah.
You know, I've heard a lot of trumpet players with a lot of technique, and they can do a lot of things, and they make him, maybe can do some things that he can't do, that he didn't do. But in terms of the language and the concept, I think he completed the circle for me. And, yeah, I loved Woody. I loved watching him play. I never got to know him well. I'd see him around, and he'd let me sit in, and we'd talk. And last time I saw him, he actually played my horn. You know, and the last time last time I saw him, he was doing his Tai Chi early in the morning in Italy in the Pompeii Jazz Festival. He was playing at the Pompeii Jazz Festival. I was playing with Steve Coleman, Five Elements, and he was playing with Paris Reunion Band. And I remember Joe Henderson was in that band. Early in the morning the next day, Woody was doing his Tai Chi, and that was the last I saw him. Mm. Last time I saw him, late 80s.
That was I love. I don't know if you want to share that story about. You told me a little bit more detail about him borrowing your horn when we were talking, setting this up. I don't know if you want to.
Oh yeah, well, Woody didn't have his horn, and he was in Italy. We were in Italy, and the promoter came to me and said, "Woody Shaw doesn't have his horn. Can he use your horn? And then he'll just give it back to you." And I said, "Yeah, are you kidding? Are you kidding?" You know. I would have given the horn and let him play the rest of the tour. And, you know, I mean, that's if I could have, I would have, you know.
Yeah.
You know, and I took it to him. I took the horn to him. We were in the same hotel. I took him my horn and he played it. And then he gave it back to me. And then we played our set. We played after they did. And, yeah. Woody used to like to jam a lot. Star Cafe comes to mind. He used to hang out at the Star Cafe.
Where was the Star Cafe?
The Star Cafe was like 20-something street on 6th, between closer to 6th, as with like 23rd Street and 6th Avenue. I think it had a pool table in there. It was like a club. It was kind of a large club with a bar, and Brian Lynch used to run the jam session there. Brian Lynch and Junior Cook used to play there a lot.
Okay, yeah.
And yeah, Woody would come through there. You know, and yeah, he was, you know, Brian was right up under Woody, just like checking everything out. I mean, all of us were, all of us were, you know.
Woody,
is this mic, this
yeah.
mic?
Yeah, it sounds like it's shorting a little bit.
Yeah.
You want to try the one next door. All right. See if that's a little friendlier.
Do I have to do anything here?
You don't got to do
check,
nothing.
Check, check, check. Okay, yeah.
That
check.
Should work.
This one is better. Okay, so good. You can turn this one off.
The home of technical difficulties. Where's Phil Schaap to call that one?
Yeah.
So I was going to just say Woody died relatively young, but he had a pretty intense career. We know him from those early Blue Notes and Out to Lunch with Eric Dolphy and then playing with Blakey. But the period we're looking at is him as a leader, late 70s, early 80s, that quintet and kind of a hallmark of hard bop in his own language, and which was not such a popular mode at that time. But he really developed that band. He had moved through a couple different bands, and he kept them together for long periods of time. And there's just a kind of go ahead.
It's interesting. You know, I listened to the other recording that you gave me from what was the other one? Not the Carnegie, the other one.
Sweden, the Kristianstad, or San Francisco?
It must have been the Kristianstad. Yeah. It's the same band. Yeah, it's the same band with Carter, with Onaji. But here's the thing. In the 60s, late 60s and 70s, the music... much to the credit of John Coltrane, Pharoah Sanders, and others, the music had become very high-level music. You know, it had become very high-level energy, high energy. But it was mostly... it had left the kind of harmonic explorations that were happening in bebop and before. And it had become very modal, like, in the sense that a lot of tunes would be in one key and they would stay in a key, and they would, like, be over, like an ostinato with a melody, and then it would play, and there would be all this energy, you know. And when I listened to that recording, I could hear... that the band at that time was coming more from that sound. As time went on, and Woody
even
changed,
though they're playing changes and playing in that.
Yeah, but even the changes, even the things with changes, are kind of relegated to a sound that was popular in the late 60s. I'm talking about. I can't think of what recordings, you know, like, I think with time, Woody experimented. He brought people in. He changed the piano chair, changed the drum chair, changed the saxophone chair. Then he had the trombone come in. You know, he was changing and finding what worked, and the music was changing. And then it became more maybe like what you said, hard bop, because it wasn't that before.
True.
See, it wasn't. It was more that sound of that modal sound that was coming out of like a Pharoah Sanders, and that, you know. And he developed the group until he brought it to a point that was somewhere kind of in between, because even though they were playing changes, he was using a lot of chords, substitute chords and things, Phrygian things that were... The chord, the harmony had changed, but the drive, it was the same. The intensity of the drive coming from the rhythm section was the same. And he kept kicking it and pushing the rhythm section, even though the harmonic language was changing, you know. And that's not just with him. That's with all the music. Like, I was around and got to hear bands and got to hear a lot of stuff in the 70s. And I got to hear the music change through the late 70s going into the 80s. Everyone was all of a sudden a lot interested in chord changes again. People were like transcribing like Charlie Parker, and there was more, a lot that was coming back. Whereas before, everybody was like into like the Church of John Coltrane and, you know, that energy, you know, which is it's a different thing. Now, for Coltrane, he was always working with chords and structures and harmonies, but he was always experimenting with things. But, you know, I was told, okay, so my trumpet teacher growing up, a man named Dave Burns, who's from New Jersey, he remembers Woody when he was young. And he always used to tell me that all those things that Woody played, he got from Larry Young. Ah, now, Larry Young is also from Newark.
Right, sure.
Larry's also from Newark. So there was a thing going on in Newark, you know, and...
That's really interesting.
And he also told me that Larry was playing all that modal stuff before McCoy Tyner was playing it.
Wow.
You know, and that John Coltrane used to come to Newark and look for Larry.
Wow.
John Coltrane, every time he would come to Newark, and probably was often because it's on the way to Philly, right?
Right.
The train was going to Philly from New York a lot. When he would go to Newark, he would ask for Larry. Where's Larry Young? And so Larry and Woody were working on these things, these ideas, you know, these harmonic things, moving chords around in a different way, using substitution chords and using suspended chords, and moving modally around in an area. In certain areas, and so that's what I was told.
You talk about that shift that was happening. This is really interesting. 70s going into 80s, and more interest in changes. I'm wondering if you think that Dexter Gordon was a big influence on Woody around this time, because they were playing together. Dexter had come back. He was, you know, he'd been living in Europe for years, and now he's back. And
Perhaps I know that when Woody played with Dexter, and I think one of the first times I saw Woody play live was with Dexter. I remember they played a gig in Central Park, and this would have been around 79 or 80. And I went to see, that was the first time I saw Woody. I had heard recordings, but I hadn't seen him yet. And I said, Woody played with Dexter. I know when Woody played with Dexter, and when he played with a lot of the more bebop-oriented players, he kind of tailored his playing a little bit to play with them. You know, he could play, you know, Woody comes out of a lineage of trumpet players, but Woody always used to talk about Lee Morgan. He loved Lee Morgan. You know, Woody loved Lee. And you can hear that in his playing. But, you know, he was like Lee with a twist. You know, I mean,
yeah.
He wasn't playing what Lee was playing, but that feeling that Lee had, he had some of that. He got that. He liked that.
Yeah.
And, so when Woody played with Dexter, or he was playing with Johnny Griffin, or whoever he was playing with, he had a way of kind of reining in his force to play in context with them. You know, because mm-hmm. they weren't playing them. But Dexter could play, you know, Dexter could stretch too, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Dexter could stretch too. So.
He could make everything sound like it was written for him, right?
Yeah. Dexter. I got to see Dexter a lot during that time. I would see Woody a lot. I mean, I would see the two of them. They would both, you know, there were certain bands who kind of had these residencies that would always come in and out of the Vanguard. There was Alvin, there was Dexter.
Right. Yeah.
There was Woody. Johnny Griffin sometimes.
Yeah.
They were coming back and forth to the Vanguard, you know, where other musicians were more like other sweet basils. Like, okay, so Art Blakey would play at Basils. He
yes.
wouldn't play at the Vanguard. I mean, I'm not saying that he wouldn't.
Right. Yeah.
But during that time, he wasn't very
He would
much.
Have a place that was his place. It was Fat Tuesdays for a while.
Yeah, and that was McCoy's place also. McCoy right. always used to play Fat Tuesdays. I
yeah.
used to always go see McCoy there. So, yeah, there were certain clubs that certain musicians would frequent, and they would, you know, they'd be killing it. They'd be burning it up.
We still haven't told the folks what that first piece was that they heard. You want to run it down for them?
All right, that was Stepping Stones, which I believe was the name of an album.
Yeah.
I think there was an album called Stepping Stones, yeah.
And so this, we said, North Sea Jazz Festival, summer of 1979. and the band. It's Carter Jefferson up front. And everybody's just shining, really sparkling on this one. Carter Jefferson in particular, I really knocked me out. Onaje Allen Gums on piano. Stafford James on the bass. Victor Lewis on the drums. And this was the working band, the quintet that Woody Shaw was playing with around that time. And, yeah, Stepping Stones was the piece that we heard. Anything, maybe we should, we only have two pieces from this night, and maybe we should play the other one and talk some more about this band.
I want to, I actually want to go, I would like to go to the Stepping Stones from that Carnegie Hall. Okay, so this is not Carnegie Hall.
No.
But it's called Carnegie
Hall. We're at Uncle Poe's Carnegie Hall, which is a club in Hamburg, West Germany. And it's that same, it's actually five nights later. It's the same band.
Wow, okay.
How about that? Of course, it's the same band. I just need a moment to cue this up. So maybe
we're going to hear the same tune.
I love that.
And it's the same band, five nights later.
So who want to talk a little bit about, while I set this up, about those four gentlemen playing with Woody at this time?
Carter, I got to know from Woody's recording. I mean, the first time I think I saw Carter was probably with Woody, and that recording, Stepping Stones, he's on that record. Carter... I remember when Carter Jefferson passed.
Yeah.
I was on my way to the Perugia Jazz Festival to play with Don Byron, and Carter had just died. And Carter was supposed to play, I think, with Fort Apache. And
he lived did he live in D.C., I think, Carter Jefferson?
I think he might have been. Maybe he's from D.C. I'm not sure. I didn't know him well. But I remember when he passed, and I was going to Alitalia to pick up my plane ticket to fly to Italy. I was playing with Don Byron, and Carter was supposed to play with some group. Maybe it was Fort Apache. And they had his ticket, and the Alitalia people said, "Well, we have this ticket for Carter Jefferson. Can we give it to you to give to him?" And I said, "No, don't give it to me. You know, Carter had died." Carter died in Poland, I think, in Poland or somewhere in East Europe. I mean, he died on stage. Yeah, just before that festival, just before. So I remember. So I didn't know Carter very well. I got to know Carter's playing through Woody, but. Onaje, who I think is from my neck of the woods. I know he lived out in Queens, and I don't know if that's where he's from, but I know he lived there. And people always used to talk about Onaje. A lot of people that I grew up around in Queens, in St. Albans and Hollis and that area, they knew Onaje. Onaje's a little older than me, so I didn't get to know him out there, but I got to know his playing through Woody and some other recordings that he did. Stafford James and Victor Lewis, all these guys, I saw them playing with Woody. I didn't really know them before, but they're all great players. They were all great players.
Yeah.
Victor and Stafford are still with us. Onaje and Carter are not.
Well, so we're going to taking the WKCR chopper from Den Haag in Netherlands over to Hamburg across the sea. And so this is another take of that same piece, Stepping Stones. The show's called Deep Focus. I'm your host, Mitch Goldman. Very pleased to be here with Graham Haynes. We are shining a bright light on Woody Shaw. Deep Focus on WKCR.
Thank you. It's March 18th, 2024, Monday night. Graham Haynes was with me talking about a collective hero, both of ours, Woody Shaw. I'm your host, Mitch Goldman. That's part one of three parts. And, you know, we get a new episode up each week, at least a new part of each show. So come on back for part two, or check out any of the hundreds of other episodes, including other shows we've done about Woody Shaw, including other shows we've done with guest Graham Haynes. You could search for all of them at the hosting site, which is mitchgoldman.podbean.com. And you can also search, if you want to look a little deeper, go to my website. It's mitchgoldman.com. Pull down the About Deep Focus tab, and you should see a Google search bar. You can look in there for more information. You can, you know, you're a resourceful person. You're going to figure this out. You can also email me if you want. It's deepfocusnow@gmail.com. Deepfocusnow@gmail.com. All right. I'll see you over at part two.